Good afternoon. My name is Sarah Shamoon, and I am a senior at the New York City Lab School in Chelsea. I am honored to be the youngest member of Manhattan's Community Board 6. I was appointed to Board 6. I was appointed to Board 6 when I was 16 and have served now for almost 2 years. Serving on the board has been the most valuable experience of my life so far. Growing up in New York City has given me a unique upbringing. I am inspired daily by the diversity of culture, architecture, small businesses, and the people. The people of New York City have taught me to be thoughtful, compassionate, empathetic, and to be accepting. Now more than ever, these values are so important that the next generation understands them. And these values are the reason I wanted to be involved in my community. I wanted to be able to help make this great city great in any way I could. When I was 14, I knew I wanted to join the community board. However, I was soon told that I had to be 18 to serve on the board. I was disappointed. It all changed when Manhattan Borough President Gale Brewer pushed Albany to pass the bill sponsored by Assemblywoman Nilly Rosick to allow 16 and 17-year-olds to serve on their community boards. Borough President Brewer understood the unique and helpful perspective teens could bring to the board. She also knew that bringing the next generation into government early would motivate them and their peers to actively participate. Being on the community board has not only allowed me to share my views, but to learn from the members of the board, some of whom have been there for many decades. In addition, having my ideas matter too and be taken into account by government officials and my fellow board members has been one of the most interesting and rewarding experiences of my 18 years.
Good afternoon. My name is Morgan Shahi. I'm a senior at Bard High School, Early College, Queens, and I am a member of the Young Leaders of Manhattan. Every young person has experienced a feeling of powerlessness and disenfranchisement, like no one will listen, a feeling that we must be quiet and wait our turn. The past year has truly demonstrated young people's willingness to participate in activism through protests and walkouts. We have shown the necessity for our voices to be heard. Young Leaders of Manhattan is an initiative sponsored by Gale Brewer to bring young people to the table to discuss and explore issues that we face in this constantly changing city. Young Leaders of Manhattan has brought to light issues that are important to us, like the environment, transportation, homelessness, and education. Young Leaders of Manhattan is so great because it shows the city and it shows the world that our representatives do care and are making an effort to understand young people's unique perspective. We cannot and will not be ignored. And acknowledging the youth is the first step towards an educated, socially aware, and prepared future. Now, without further ado, please welcome the Manhattan Borough President, Gale Brewer.
Thank you very much, Sarah and Morgan. And Sarah turned 18 yesterday, so happy birthday, Sarah. Thank you all for bearing the bad weather to come today, and if you're watching on the web or on MNN, thanks for tuning in. We're live, so folks at home can watch us. I want to thank the performers of Harlem Samba, all students, alum, and friends of the Frederick Douglass Academy in Harlem, and a special shout out to the amazing director, Dana Matero. Harlem Samba is modeled after the Brazilian samba schools known as baterias that perform in the Brazilian carnival. So give them an extra round of applause. So now, without further ado, I would like to have a few words from my good friend, the wonderful public advocate, Tish James. Come on up, Tish.
Good evening, Manhattan.
Good
My friend Gale Brewer is by far the hardest working politician, not only in New York City, but all across this nation. If you agree, make some noise. She is courageous. And unlike a lot of politicians, she's not a transactional politician. No, she's a transformative one. And her finger is always on the pulse of the people. She, as I have often described, she is a 21st century Eleanor Roosevelt. There's no question about it. And now more than ever, during this storm, with a cloud over our nation, now as the sky gets dark, now what we need more than ever is we need stars to shine the brightest. And Borough President Gale Brewer, her star is certainly shining. Because we need to fight back against the forces that stoke fear in the hearts and minds of the most vulnerable and the most marginalized. And so, unlike other State of the Borough addresses, tonight our focus should be on fighting back the dangers, as Dr. Martin Luther King once said, sincere ignorance and conscientious stupidity. And individuals need to know, particularly at 1600 Pennsylvania Avenue, that no one is above the law, not even the President of these United States. And so we must resist through sustained organizing, turning red states blue, registering to vote, educating and empowering others, and rising and raising our voices by stating that when our rights are under attack, we need to fight back, and that all refugees and all immigrants are welcomed here. Congratulations, Gale Brewer, and thank you.
And now it's my great pleasure to introduce another Upper West Sider, the controller, Scott Stringer.
Thank you very much, and it is great to be at a Manhattan State of the Borough address. I gave a few of them in my time. And first, I wanted to say something about Gale Brewer. Let's face it, when Gale finished that amazing, distinguished career in the city council, some people said, now she's borough president, she's got big, big shoes to fill. And let's face it, Gale Brewer has exceeded everyone's expectation of what a great public servant is all about. And the job of borough president has never been more important than it is today. Because at the end of the day, people don't realize that this borough is many different neighborhoods weaved together. It's a diverse borough, people from all different backgrounds, all different walks of life. And it takes a very strong leader to protect our neighborhoods from gentrification and overdevelopment, but it's also, we need somebody who has demonstrated the ability for smart urban planning, land use and zoning, and that is something that she has brought to this job like nobody's business. And lastly, I just want to, let's give that a round of applause for that. And lastly, I've known Gale since I was a little boy, and as the first teenager ever appointed to the community board, she says illegally back in the 70s, I do want to say that her appointment and her work to pass legislation to get young people involved in politics is now more important than ever, because the truth is, with Trump as president, so many activists and advocates took us to this point, and now we need that next generation. The only way we're going to have that next generation is if we embrace the young political activists, and what a great way to start. So Gale, I know you're just getting started. The best is yet to come. Congratulations on yet another sellout State of the Borough. Thank you all. It's great to see everybody.
Thank you both very much. It is true that our State of the Borough events have always been a little different, and today we are continuing our tradition of talking and participating and not just listening. It's a moment that can't help but be different because of President Trump, whose actions and appointments challenge not just policies we support and depend on, but even the basic ideas of America that we thought were sacrosanct. Whether it's immigration, or constitutional and human rights, or foreign and national security policy, or environmental policy, or trade policy, or health and education policy, urban policy, the arts, a woman's right to choose, tax cut for the 1%, or nuclear weapons, Donald Trump has given every one of us who cares about New York and the world something to worry about and talk about and organize about. For instance, my feet are soaking wet, so are Tish's and so are Scott's and others, because we were all at a rally at the Battery this morning. You know, for starters, he sparked the greatest wave of activism in a long time. Not just the marches and the pop-up rallies, the ones over the travel ban were really inspiring, but a boom in contributions to organizations we're going to need, like the ACLU, NRDC, Planned Parenthood. So naturally, the topic of this year's panel is activism and what it means now. In a little while, you'll hear from a wonderful panel, including Jennifer Jones Austin. She is the CEO of the Federation of Protestant Welfare Agencies. Angela Fernandez, she's the Executive Director of Northern Manhattan Coalition for Immigrant Rights. Janella Hinds, who's both a union member, a head of the United Federation of Teachers for High Schools, and with the New York Central Labor Council. Andrew Rasiej, he's the founder of Civic Hall and the Personal Democracy Forum and a real techie. And my friend Gene Stone, the Trump Survival Guide author. A word about the screens you'll see at the side of the stage. Normally you're asked to silence your phone. Please don't silence your phone. Make it work, because I want you to join in the conversation of Twitter. All week, we asked New Yorkers to tweet their ideas for getting involved in the new era of activism using hashtag SOTB2017, State of the Borough 17. Please do the same now, and we'll put your tweets up on the screen. Let us know if you want to follow us on Twitter and Facebook. It's just Gale A. Brewer. And if you have any specific questions down the line, I'm G. Brewer, Manhattan BP, NYC Gov. That's G. Brewer at manhattanbp.nyc.gov. I answer it, and everybody in Manhattan has that damn email. I am very, very honored to have many individuals from the city here. I want to thank Congresswoman Carolyn Maloney, who was here earlier. I want to thank Senator Brad Hoyleman. I want to thank Councilmember Ben Kalos. I want to thank some of our wonderful community board chairs, Anthony Natero from Board 1, Rick Eggers from Board 6, Commissioner Fenosky Pena Mora, who shows up, and he's from DDC, building our wonderful opportunities for design and building in the city of New York. And I also want to thank Board 12, Richard Lewis, Jim Klein, Community Board 8 Chair. And I want to thank Council Member Johnson, who's here, and Assembly Member Shaw, and Assembly Member Gottfried, and Board 12 Chair Shah Ali. These are just some of the people who are here today. Thank you. I certainly want to thank all the non-elected New Yorkers who are here, talented and dedicated community members. You have stepped forward to serve your neighborhood, your borough, and our city. We'll need you more than ever, each and every person, in the years ahead. Some of you are on the community board. Some of you are on other volunteer boards that manage the borough, organizing your block or your tenant association or your co-op or your condo. And there are the phenomenal NYCHA leaders. Thank you very much, NYCHA leaders. You're a district leader, a state committee member, a PTA at your child's school. You serve in the auxiliary police. You serve as a CERT member. You're a precinct council volunteer. You're on the business improvement district, the Chamber of Commerce. Take that, Mr. Trump. When have you done any of those things? Before we get to our panelists, I want to talk about what we've been doing on your behalf. As you'll hear, I've worked hard to go beyond what the city charter requires of borough presidents. The charter, and most people don't know, what in the world does a borough president do? The charter gives a borough president the authority to help shape major land use projects, appoint and assist the 600 members of Manhattan's 12 community boards. We also appoint to the school boards, cultural boards, park boards, bid boards, hospital boards, and the Solid Waste Advisory Board. And all of those are ways that you can get involved. The borough president has two other charter mandated roles: co-sponsoring legislation in the city council and helping to shape the budget. And I'm trying my best to use these powers to their maximum extent. So in my term, I've introduced 45 bills and resolutions, and 10 have become law. And let me be specific about some of the ones that might be of interest to you. I'm particularly proud of one co-sponsored with council member Margaret Chin. You may remember what happened a year or so ago when the city lifted the deed restriction on Rivington House on the Lower East Side, and it slipped away to a developer who could turn it into multi-million dollar condos, although he hasn't done so yet. Councilmember Chin and I passed Local Law 176 to make sure it never happens again. We do not want to lose deed restrictions. So under the law, the city must maintain a public database of deed restrictions on such projects. No more, oops, we didn't know. And an open review is now required to the city and the community whenever such actions are proposed. Another bill that passed. With Councilmember Jamani Williams, we passed the Fair Chance Act. It makes it illegal for employers to ask about the criminal record of a job applicant before making a job offer. Applicants must now be judged on their qualifications alone, and only after a conditional job offer is made can an employer inquire about a criminal history. And I've heard from retail union that is making a positive difference for people with criminal records to get a job. A job is how you stay out of jail in the future. In the area of public safety, we passed legislation that increased the number of accessible pedestrian signals on our streets, reducing the danger to blind or partially sighted. But we need to do a lot more on pedestrian safety for all of our sakes. And I know in particular that Councilmember Helen Rosenthal has been working on public safety on our streets. We hope to pass a law. This is really bizarre that we have to do this. We hope to pass a law that would mandate that addresses have to be on a building, including the side entrances. How many times have you looked for a building and it was hard to find because there's no address? That has happened to me so many times. I want to talk about a topic that the controller mentioned and that is so important to New York, which is housing and zoning. In 2016, my office reviewed 19 ULURP recommendations, those are for zoning, as you know, as part of our obligation to comment on major land use applications. We have completed 71 reviews since 2014, and 11 more are due in April. Half of our approvals were conditional on the developer improving benefits to the community or increasing affordable housing. Getting more affordable housing into every new residential development that comes before my office is a top priority, as it is yours. And often we succeed. In the Ladies Mile Historic District, when it was unclear whether the new mandatory affordable housing rules applied, we supported Councilmember Johnson's effort to get more affordable units by using a little-known charter provision called the triple no to send the application to the council for approval. And honestly, sometimes we have failed to increase the number of affordable units at projects under review. It's one of my deepest frustrations that we are fighting so hard and long with you just to get a few more units into projects when the demand is so great. Just to give an example, at one development in East Harlem with 88
available units, they received over 78,000 applications. And at a project on Lower Madison Avenue with 64 units, over 100,000 applications were submitted. Creating new units is just part of the challenge. The New York University Furman Center projects that 13,911 units of subsidized rental housing, often by HUD, just in Manhattan, will be eligible to opt out of these subsidies over the next 7 years. We work with building owners, housing agencies, and nonprofits to develop affordable units after their current subsidies expire. So we are trying to address these issues. Right now, we're working with a Mitchell-Ama with 120 units, mostly seniors and low-income families. If we succeed in getting nonprofit ownership, all tenants forever will pay no more than 30% of annual income for rent and support services, but that's just one building. Again, I want to thank the NYCHA leaders for being here and say that all discussions of housing have to include the long-term opportunities for maintenance at NYCHA. And we work with the NYCHA residents to advocate for what they are entitled to as residents and leaders, and we hope that there will be more Section 3 opportunities, which means that people can get jobs as the buildings are renovated. It's very important. I also want to thank Councilmember Mark Levine, who has a bill that states that individuals in housing court who meet a certain income should be able to get an attorney, and I think the mayor and he are having a press conference on that right now. Our commitment to save the units we have and create new ones is a top priority every single day. East Midtown. When pending land use applications will significantly impact the residents of Manhattan, we have gone beyond our charter mandate by recommending and pushing for ways to reshape them. Last year, Councilmember Dan Goronick and I co-chaired the East Midtown Steering Committee. Working closely with the Department of City Planning, we created a revised master zoning proposal for that area around Grand Central. New zoning there is crucial to the city's well-being because property values in East Midtown, get this, generate 10% of all city property taxes in the entire city. Another amazing fact, One Vanderbilt, the new skyscraper going up next to Grand Central, right now it's just a hole, but there were buildings there. For One Vanderbilt, the new skyscraper going up next to Grand Central, property taxes on the site before it was torn down were $8 million. When the new building is built, the property taxes will be $50 million a year. It's a very interesting example of the importance of building commercial in the right locations. In addition, One Vanderbilt will create three needed amenities: a large public plaza next to the terminal in an area that doesn't have much open space, a revenue stream to keep upkeep of the area's landmark buildings, and $220 million in subway improvements, including a new transit hall connected to Grand Central. Councilmember Gorodnick and I used the East Midtown rezoning plan to bring all the stakeholders together to prioritize community and commercial development. As always, compromise is required. I hate compromise, but you gotta do it. I would love to, of course, see more landmarking of historic commercial buildings. Others seek more protection of their neighborhood from increased development and disruption, but we all work together. It's a major step, this East Midtown plan, toward rationalized, planned commercial development that will help this critical part of New York grow in a more balanced way. This kind of pre-ULURP planning shortens development time, reduces costs, and leads to significant planned improvements. We are also pre-planning in East Harlem with Speaker Melissa and Mark Viverito, in Inwood with Councilmember Udonis Rodriguez, in Chinatown and Soho NoHo, and the South Street Seaport with Councilmember Chin, and we're working on planning groups to figure out how New Jersey and Manhattan should commute in a planned way, and collaborating on resiliency with Councilmember Rosie Mendez and the mayor's office. We're all aware, however, that this building boom has adverse effects. The most sobering is a surge in the number of workers hurt and killed in construction accidents. To respond, I convened the Manhattan Construction Safety Working Group in the autumn of 2015. Stakeholders from the industry created key recommendations, and we worked to develop legislation that strengthens requirements for health, safety, and craft training, and makes monetary penalties for safety violations too costly to ignore. This is now part of a package in the City Council. It's controversial, but what in New York City is not controversial? I'm hoping that the end result is that construction workplaces are safer today and that they will save lives in the future. My favorite topic, community boards. The surge in activism nationally is inspiring people to get involved locally. We've seen more than a 35% increase in new applicants to our community boards compared to even last year. We just received 1,010 applications for the 12 community boards in the borough of Manhattan. Way back in 2014, we only got 328 new applicants. So you can see that people are interested, and I am so appreciative. It's the diversity of new faces, perspective, and constituencies, all this new leadership, as well as the important individuals who have been serving for a long time who give us all strength. And I also heard earlier, you heard from Sarah Shamoon about her role as a 16, 17-year-old on the community board. That is due to, it was my initiative, but it was Ben Kalos, council member in the city council, and Neely Rosick and the state legislature who made it possible. So I want to thank Ben Kalos for making that a reality in our city. It is true that we have a hunger to be civically engaged, but at the community boards, much of the increase in participation is also due to the incredible work of Deputy Borough President Aldrin Bonilla and his team. He brings attention to the importance of the boards, and he made this effective work even more effective by community planning. In the past year, our community board leadership development program trained 555 community members, other borough president appointees, and community residents, and we learned about land use, zoning, landmarks, conflict of interest, very important, budget, open data, data mapping, parliamentary procedure, and how to write resolutions. That is what makes a sustainable community board member. We also train CUNY students to become experts in open data, and they work with the community boards to use the data portal effectively. These reforms, our training, and technical support are unprecedented among the boroughs. With all due respect to my other borough presidents, people come from other boroughs to go to these workshops. They represent our goal to create a legacy of empowerment in our communities that will last for a generation. I also want to just mention that as the borough president, we have a solid waste advisory board, and in this discussion of our planet and our city and our sustainability, this group of many like-minded but professional on the issue of the environment is incredibly important. It's a non-governmental organization dedicated to recycling, reducing solid waste, and advancing solid waste policy in our city. In 2016, I increased the membership from 20 to 35 due to the large number of applications we received, and they are meeting with the community boards to have an understanding of what each does. SWAB has now elections, they have a new executive board, they've been testifying at different hearings, and in the past, their fundraisers paid for a compost grant program. And this year, because they raise a lot more money, they're also having and promoting a grant for reuse and repair. Again, an example of what you can do when you are wondering what is the best way to deal with these issues, bring people together. We also have a seat on the NYCERS, which is the pension board. And among the boards we have sought to improve are those of NYCERS and the other four pension systems. Here too, Deputy Borough President Bonilla has led the way, creating a first-time partnership with CUNY's Baruch School of Business to provide investment training to trustees of all five systems and to make Baruch the permanent home of that annual training. They used to go to other cities, but why would we go to other cities when we have Baruch? I want to mention we also, just like the mayor and the council members, allocate funding, particularly on capital. We allocated over $26 million to 185 schools and parks and libraries and nonprofits last year, and we've allocated about $70 million since 2014. Here, full credit goes to the leadership of Deputy Borough President Matthew Washington on the budget staff, because I make their work very hard because I want to give money to everybody who applies. We just don't have enough to meet the need. I'm very proud that one of our priorities last year was to fund the restoration and the maintenance for the square rigged ship Waver Tree, which recently returned to the South Street Seaport Museum after a fabulous restoration in Staten Island. I was so glad that didn't get restored in New Jersey. The Waver Tree serves as a shining testament to our city as it welcomes home to immigrants. It makes us understand our history. We also have funding that comes from the Theater Sub-District Council. We sit on this district council. It is the funding from the landmark air rights, landmark from the theaters in Midtown. And in 2016, our office announced over $2 million in grant funding for organizations committed to training and diversifying the theater workforce through paid apprenticeships and fellowships. Again, trying to reach underrepresented groups for jobs in the theater world. We also have cultural grants. We work with NYC and Company to fund and administer cultural tourism grants. We support marketing and audience development for neighborhoods across the borough who are interested in promoting the great arts and culture of our borough. Finally, you can testify on any budget item you wish in the borough of Manhattan on Wednesday, February 15th from 4 to 7 at CUNY's Gutman College, 50 West 40th Street, and that is the Manhattan Borough Board budget hearing this Wednesday. I wouldn't be Gale if I didn't worry about small business and the mom and pops. It is perhaps something that I care more about than any other policy item. It is a very hard issue to make real. We tried on the west side with zoning, and now in preparing our small business report in 2015, we highlighted the fact that the commercial rent tax is only assessed in the area between 96th Street and Murray Street. And it is onerous, an unfair burden on small business located in the central business district. Not fair that Manhattan businesses are the only businesses to pay this tax. We've seen all the phenomenon of small business of all kinds closing. We know that our supermarkets, I feel that they're going to be an endangered species along with the gas station. They are harming the neighborhood by leaving, and their loss is not offset by another national chain drugstore stocking milk and cereal. I don't buy milk and cereal from them. That's why, with Councilmember Johnson, to reduce the commercial rent tax, we are introducing a bill to help affordable supermarkets. That bill is scheduled for a hearing tomorrow in the City Council's Finance Committee. I hope you'll support it. Also, as another effort to help small businesses grow, we introduced legislation that experiments with support for small food-oriented startups. It's always seemed to me that our large, health-inspected, professional school kitchens that lie dormant after lunchtime could be utilized by small businesses. Our food vendor license bill includes a school kitchen pilot to test my idea. You know, much of our work doesn't rise to coverage on a newspaper or on TV, sometimes on New York One. I love New York One. But at meetings and phone calls and letters, that's often where our most creative work takes place. Let me give you a few examples of terrific things that we have done in the past year that are under the media radar. First and foremost, helping public schools is a big part of our office. We pressure the Department of Education to help Mott Hall Middle School from moving away from its campus at City College, and we won. We got $500,000 in funding for the school-based mental health clinic at the High School for Math, Science, and Engineering at City College. We prevented 241 on West 113th Street from being consolidated, and now there's a planning process for the schools in the area. This one is my favorite. We secured music instruction and a full band of instruments where there was none. In the high school for media and communications, which shares the George Washington educational campus with other schools, and they were supported from Amp Up NYC. There was no music with 2,500 students on that campus. We are advocating that iPads and Chromebooks be purchased with city funds and added to the laptops now in public school computer carts. And in keeping with my push for technology literacy, we were instrumental in getting the Mouse Tutoring Program, which is a wonderful program, into four more schools so students can learn peer-to-peer. We're working on the Department of Education to improve research outreach for new Community Education Council members. And if you want to join one of the six Manhattan CECs, come to an information session on February 22nd in our office at 1 Center Street. In the past year, we have sponsored 87 workshops, information sessions, and celebrations to get the word out about important government programs. One was controversial. It was on driverless cars. And although controversial, guess what? The technology is happening. We all need to get educated and keep all options open. Research indicates that these driverless cars save lives. Receptions take place in our art gallery is another example of what we're doing at 1 Center Street because we have a new exhibit every single month. Currently, it is an exhibit of extraordinary quilts created by the New York Quilters of Color. Activities at our first ever Manhattan Borough President to have a street-level storefront office at 431 West 125th Street. And we have many discussions and workshops in addition to helping people out of that office. It's a neighborhood center. We have clinics and help sessions and a wonderful staff that helps thousands of individuals with questions and problems. Perhaps my favorite outreach initiative is our partnership with Grow NYC and more than a dozen senior centers. There we deliver fresh, locally grown fruit and vegetables for just $8 a shopping bag, and it's worth about $20. This year, the Fresh Food for Seniors program has expanded to include neighborhoods stretching from the West Village to Northern Manhattan and now Roosevelt Island. Very special. I want to thank certain people. First of all, every single person who made the effort to be here today. I thank you from the bottom of my heart. I want to thank Councilmember Mark Levine for being here. I hope he got all of what we requested earlier in terms of we want a lawyer for every person going to housing cart, Mark. I know you're going to be able to do that. And I want to thank Corey Johnson, who I mentioned earlier, who's done a lot of great work. Thank you both. Before I thank the staff, I want to thank my husband, Cal Snyder, and my son, Mo. I want to thank Penelope Cox and her staff in the Borough President's Office for coordinating today's event. I want to thank the people here at Manhattan Center, and I want to thank Manhattan Neighborhood Network for their wonderful work providing their video coverage. President and CEO Dan Coughlin, Managing Director Greg Sutton, and my friend Zenaida Mendez, who's director of their Firehouse Community Media Center. So, without further delay, the best part of the program is not Gale Brewer. It's the panelists from whom we will learn much more about the era of activism. Thank you all very much. Wonderful panel. I want to introduce them and then we're going to ask some questions about how in the world do we deal with Mr. Trump. Angela Fernandez is an attorney and she's executive director of Northern Manhattan Coalition for Immigrant Rights. She's also newly the president of the Dominican Day Parade. She's a first generation immigrant, a graduate of Boston University and Columbia University of Law, and she has a huge amount of experience that is invaluable generally, but particularly today. So thank very much for being here today, Angela. Jennifer Jones Austin is the CEO and Executive Director of the Federation of Protestant Welfare Agencies. As you know, it is a policy organization with 180 human service member agencies. She was before Senior Vice President of United Way, and she has done many other things in the city of New York. She has a law degree from Fordham University of Law, a master's degree in management from the Robert Wagner Graduate School of Public Service at NYU, and a BA from Rutgers University. Andrew Rocher, he's a civic and social entrepreneur, technology strategist, and the founder of Civic Hall, which if you haven't been there, is the most wonderful place to be in the city of New York. It is a center for technology and innovative technology, and he's also the founder of Mouse that I mentioned earlier, and he has put together all of the internet gatherings in the city of New York. He's a graduate of Cooper Union. Janella Hinds is Secretary Treasurer of the New York City Central Labor Council, where she is responsible for oversight that represents workers in 400 public and private sector unions. She focuses on the high schools at the union, but she's also a Vice President of the Central Labor Council, Secretary Treasurer of the Central Labor Council. She is a graduate of Princeton University and a master's in education from New York University. Gene Stone, he has been my friend for 45 years. Wow. He is a former Peace Corps volunteer. He is an author of about, 49 books, but most recently he's the author of The Trump Survival Guide. Now I am not Kelly Ann Conway and I am not hawking jewelry, but this is a great book. So I'm going to start with you, Angela, and I think, for all of us, today and in the past, what's the difference in the kinds of activism we need to do? And what are some of the tools that an organization like yours and with your amazing leadership, what could we be doing to be more active? I know I read just the other day on the web that your wonderful organizations need support, as an example. So why don't you talk a little bit about what you are doing? Goodness knows what you're thinking about in terms of the immigrants and the refugees is front and center of your work.
Well, thank you very much, and thank you for this amazing opportunity.
Thank you.
To speak about our organization. Northern Manhattan Coalition for Immigrant Rights is a community. You can't hear me? It's the first time anyone wants me to speak louder. Is that better? Great. So Northern Manhattan Coalition for Immigrant Rights is a community-based organization centered up in Northern Manhattan, but we also serve people from the Bronx and actually from all over the city and from other states. In this time today, community-based organizations are the lifeboat for our communities in these uncertain waters. Our organization right now is receiving hundreds of calls a day from immigrants that are concerned and petrified about the uncertainty of this time. And so while we provide legal services, which we've done very well for 35 years, specifically to immigrants, we have also been at the front line of advocacy and identified areas where policies haven't been working, come up with the solutions based on what people who are directly impacted by these policies tell us, and actually then change them. And we've been very successful at that. For example, recently, our organization was at the forefront of having the city of New York pay for a universal representation program for detained immigrants. Many of you may not know, you can be detained as an immigrant and can be deported forever, but you don't have a constitutional right to a paid attorney. We identified that as an issue because our organization was getting inundated with calls from detention centers and educated city council, educated the mayor, and they agreed to fund a program where right now, today, it was important 2 years ago when we got it done, it is more important today because lawyers are our first responders in this climate. Fortunately, our founding fathers had the vision and understanding that if we had a president that wanted to flout the law, Congress would check that president. Congress is not checking him right now. So now we have the courts that are checking the policies that are coming out of the White House. So please, today, if you know a lawyer, give him a big hug, because we are going to continue to need them as they responded to JFK. We're gonna need them today, we're gonna need them going forward. And if you support an organization that's a community-based organization, that support will go very far. Because individuals that live in these neighborhoods don't know how to access the ACLU. They don't know how to access the Planned Parenthoods necessarily. Those are excellent organizations. We have to continue supporting them too. But community-based organizations provide that connective tissue. And our staff, they come from the community and know those needs specifically. So support either with funding, support with, I'm gonna do a pitch, we need new computers. If anyone works with a company that is willing to donate computers to our organization, we will take it. Or thirdly, donating with your time. If we have US citizens, right now being a US citizen is a privilege. If you are a US citizen and you're willing to visit, to accompany an immigrant that has a final order of deportation to their check-in, please come and talk to us. Because right now, more than ever, the laws fighting through the courts are important, but community pressure and moral pressure is another tool that we have. And that is also something that we specialize in. So there's so much more that I can talk about, but I'll stop here.
Well, thank you, Angela. I mean, I was really shocked, but understanding the reality when I heard you speak recently at a church. And one of the things you said, because there were a lot of people in the audience who don't have papers. Mm-hmm. And one of the things you said is, don't go to a rally. Don't participate in a protest. Be careful if you get on a plane. I know you might have relatives in California, but I have to say, don't visit them right now. That was such an un-American thing to have to say, not that you wanted to. Is that something that's correct?
Yes. I encourage you all to go to the White House, even if you don't want to, go to the White House website, look at the executive orders. Look at the three signed executive orders that were two signed on January 25th and one signed on the 27th. All three of those outline what they want to do vis-a-vis immigrants in the United States. And there's an area around interior enforcement, and it provides a tremendous amount of leeway to immigration agents in making determinations on who they can decide should be deported. And in some, there's some Section 5, C and Section 5G, C is chilling. It says that if an immigration agent determines that you may have committed a crime, yet you haven't been charged, you could be arrested and deported. The last one, G, says if the immigration agent suspects that you are a danger to the public or a danger to the national security, you can also be arrested. So what does that mean? If you are a person at a protest, can an immigration agent then determine based on that activity or determine based on what's on your Facebook feed, which we have reports of immigration agents for people coming into the country looking, asking for their passcode and looking and seeing at what's on their Facebook. So we're in a very different time right now. And it's all there in black and white, and that's one of our biggest concerns. So we are telling people, advising people, not only undocumented, but even documented, if you are a green card holder and you have had some kind of interaction with the law in the past, no matter how minor it is, please come to an organization like ours or speak to an experienced immigration attorney and tell them, this is what happened to me 20 years ago when I had an interaction, when I got arrested. I want to travel, should I travel? And allow and hear the advice and then make your decision determination based on that.
Thank you, Angela. Jennifer, you have in your purview so many human service organizations, many of which I know and respect. And one of the issues that I talk about when I speak at this unbelievable number of rallies that we all go to is the fear, not only for the immigrant and refugee community, but also for the nonprofit sector, mm-hmm. because so much of our work is the bedrock of self-sufficiency and survival for New Yorkers. So I'm just wondering whether it's a, goodness knows, a block grant for Medicaid, which to me would be an anathema, or cutting community development block grant, or et cetera. Those are sometimes terms that people don't know if you're not in government, but they help us.
Yes.
So I'm just wondering in terms of the threats to your safety net for your organizations.
So we first have to appreciate that here in New York City, the social safety net has already been under threat. We have to remember at all times that while we are having to deal with the changes that will come with the Trump administration, we also have to deal with the problems that have been in existence even before then. So here in New York City, the human services sector, which provides critical social safety net supports like public assistance act, enrollment, enrollment for food supports, enrollment for childcare, access to affordable housing, and I could go on and on and on, UPK, after school supports, elderly supports in the form of senior centers and home meals. This sector has been underfunded for decades now. And so it's already been operating on a thread. And we have to appreciate that we have to continue working with the city and with the state to get much needed funding to keep these nonprofit organizations open, alive, and thriving. Now, we all should be clapping for that, because the truth of the matter is that half of New Yorkers are struggling to make ends meet. And research has shown that there's a greater likelihood than not that any one of us might be in need of public support, assistance at some point in our lives. As it concerns what is happening with the Trump administration, we heard throughout his campaign that he was seeking to make certain changes. Interestingly, he never really addressed the poor. He never talked about a poverty agenda. He talked about doing more for, quote, the blacks. He talked about privatizing Medicare. He talked about, borrowing from Paul Ryan, block granting Medicaid. Well, what we can expect is that if any of those things happen, there's a very good likelihood that people will go without much needed services. If there are changes to the Affordable Care Act, it is quite likely that with the block granting of Medicaid or with the privatization of Medicare, we'll see fewer and fewer people actually receiving, fewer poor people, older people, and people with disabilities receiving much needed health care. What happens in those instances? Then we need more mental health supports. We need more other physical supports for people. So we have to be very careful about that. If he takes action against New York City because we are a sanctuary city and cannot cut our funding directly as it concerns law enforcement and homeland security, there's a good likelihood that through the reconciliation budgeting process, he'll come after social services. He'll look to cut things like Medicaid, things like Medicare. He'll look to cut things like housing supports, food supports, Head Start supports, other child care supports. And what does that mean? That means that vulnerable, low-income populations will be the ones to bear the burden, the ones to suffer. So what do we need to do? We need to stand up and we need to fight this. We need to fight this not just at the federal level, by taking on our senators and our congresspersons and pushing them to stand up, but we also have to fight it at the state level and at the city level. And we have to make sure that as New Yorkers, we do not allow in the budgeting process, whether it be at the federal level, at the state level, or at the city level, that the budgets get balanced on the backs of poor people. Do you understand what I'm saying? We should all be clapping for that. We've got to stand up. And what I also want to add to this is that we need to make sure that our leaders in our communities are standing up too. So I am the daughter, the granddaughter, and the great-granddaughter of Baptist ministers, civil rights leaders, and social justice activists. I was taught that the faith leadership, that the community of faith leaders should be standing up for the poor, because that is the gateway into heaven. We don't see as much of that today. We should be calling on our faith leaders to engage in these fights with us. We should be demanding that of them. And we should be looking to the business community to stand up and do its part. If more and more of us suffer, they're going to see the result of that when they don't have people who are educated, housed, and healthy enough to engage in the workforce. They need all of us, so we should be pushing them to stand up as well.
Thank you, Jen. Thank you very much. You know, two things that Jennifer said, which are not humorous because they are real. One is that John Kelly, I believe head of Homeland Security, said today, I never heard of Sanctuary City. Uh-huh. And the second thing is, this is Gale Brewer talking, but you know, you see on television, thank goodness, all of these individuals in Utah and elsewhere, you know, rising up against these absolutely abominable elected officials, and thank goodness they're doing that. But you know, we have great ones in New York, so we don't have anything to do. I'm just saying. I'm kidding. We have great ones, that's a good thing, but I get a little jealous when they can go rabble-rouse at one of those people's offices. Andrew, thank you very much for joining us, and thank you for all your work on leading us in the technology sector in New York, particularly on the civic side. And I want to ask you a couple of things. One is, we all went to JFK on a moment's notice, and it was so, I have been to many demonstrations, as we all have, but that was a great one. And it was due to the amazing opportunities offered by the work of social media. So I'm wondering what that was really tech-enabled activism, so I'm wondering what other opportunities exist in the future, number one. And number two, like you, we all testified in the Obama administration and FCC to keep net neutrality. And now all of a sudden, people may not know what that is, but it's really important to us as Americans. So I'm wondering if you could address just those two topics.
Well, sure, Gail. Thank you for having me. And since you mentioned elected leaders in New York, how great would this country be if every elected leader was as principled, hardworking, and as dedicated as Gale Brewer?
Thank you, Andrew. Thank you.
So New York has the most diverse and empathetic technology community in the world. Whenever you hear the term Silicon Valley, that's a place that doesn't really refer to the whole tech community. Here in New York, for example, the New York Tech Alliance has 60,000 members. And they're not just technologists. They're actually people in every major field in New York who are trying to understand how to use these technologies to advance their businesses or their nonprofits or their careers and try to make sense of how this fast-moving world can actually make the world a better place. And since the election, many technologists in New York have stood up to try to join with public interest organizations to defend civil liberties and human rights, to defend data that's very important to keep because the federal government will take data such as climate change data and labor data and change it and change the historical record. And there are people working on taking that data and actually taking it offshore to protect it. There are others who are also working on helping to encrypt the communications of very important public interest organizations. So if you haven't done it already, you should take a data encryption workshop or course to protect your communications, particularly those who are vulnerable, because there are technologies that are being developed by nefarious people who, for example, would like to give the police the ability to check the social media profiles of African Americans when they pull them off to the side of the road to see whether they tweeted about Black Lives Matter. Or companies that are working for the Department of Defense and Homeland Security who are building huge databases using AI to identify where 11 million undocumented people may be hiding in the United States. Technology is a tool. Like a hammer, it can build a house or it can hurt someone. And we have a technology community in New York that's actually trying to focus most of its energy on making sure that technology is used as something for the public interest and for the public good, and not just for making money and making it easier for us to get our food delivered faster or to be able to find a car or a roommate. But Gail, to answer your question, yes, for those of you who don't know what net neutrality is, net neutrality is a rule that was fought for by the tech community in New York and others, where it would make it illegal for a cable company or a telephone company to give special access to higher paying customers to allow a message or a piece of content to go through, so that the small public interest organization would have the same speed of being able to deliver a message over the internet as NBC, Universal, or General Electric, or any other major corporation. That rule is now being targeted by the new FCC chairman to basically roll back what was a very hard-fought fight several years ago. But Gail, I don't know if you heard this, but he also, within a few days of taking office, barred nine internet companies from providing low-cost internet access to the poor. So what this administration is doing is, one, they're getting us all to look over here at this, for example, the Muslim ban. And while we're all looking over here, they're doing a whole bunch of stuff over here that we're not paying attention to. And we have to be very, very vigilant. We need to support our journalists and journalistic organizations that will fight for the truth. We need to protect the social safety net. There's a project coming out of Civic Hall that's trying to make machine-readable and searchable all the information from every nonprofit organization and city agency that currently is not machine-readable. If a police officer runs into a homeless person on the street and wants to find a shelter, the police officer cannot find a shelter on his phone that will tell him whether it's open and if it has an available bed or if it has a program that will help that homeless person, because there's just a general address that there's a place. The social safety net needs to be as machine readable and searchable as our fast food deliveries.
That's right.
And we also need visionary leaders in office. There is a bill that's been proposed along the line of the social safety net by Councilman Ben Kalos, who's sitting right here with us, called automatic benefits, which says that if the city of New York knows that a person is eligible for a benefit, they don't have to apply. They should just send them that benefit. So even though we are all in shock and awe about what's happening in Washington and across our country, let's remember something. We actually won the popular vote. More people in the United States agree with us than don't agree with us. And those who came before us fought hard and taught us how to fight again. And the opportunity to be able to link these protests in a way that captures their energy, creates sustainability, gives positive feedback, and not only defeats this administration, but creates an entire new era of civic engagement for civil society, that's the opportunity, that's the optimism that we should have today.
Thank you, Andy. So, in Janella, we have somebody so special because she's both a union leader and a highly decorated educator. So, on the education front, I stood in front of Tweed complaining, didn't help at all, about the new Secretary of Education in our country. Horrible situation. And in addition, we want, obviously, to make sure that labor continues and grows, and yet we know some of the suggestions that are coming out of the White House. So I'm wondering if you could talk a little bit about, in your role both at the Central Labor Council and also as a teacher and a member of the UFT, what some of these challenges are for our future.
Thank you so much, Gail, for having us here today and for giving me this opportunity to talk about the role of labor in this whole piece. We here in New York City, we're a labor town, right? And so many of us are represented by the strong labor unions here in the city. And we're continuing to fight for safe construction sites, as Gail mentioned earlier. We're continuing to fight for union grocery stores, especially in the food deserts around the city. We're continuing to push for quality after-school programs and summer school programs and summer youth employment for our students. And the labor movement is pushing for that kind of legislation, those kinds of policy decisions to happen, not only in New York City, where we do have many progressive leaders that want to work together to make sure that people are protected by the safety net, but across our state, and certainly across the country. The challenge is so much greater when you think about what we face under this new administration. But I always remind myself when I think about someone like Betsy DeVos that we've had enemies in the Department of Education for quite some time. There have been people who looked at public education and teachers' unions as if we are villains, as if we are in place to be harmful to students rather than to uplift and to educate and to promote and empower the young people of our country. When I look at what this administration has done in this short 3 weeks, it's easy to get concerned, it's easy to get disappointed. But I'm so inspired by all that we've done in the past 3 weeks. I'm inspired by what we did at JFK. I'm inspired by the ways in which the Senate Democrats had to stand up and push back against those DeVos and Sessions confirmations. And no, we weren't successful. It's true, they're still in office right now. But the voices of the people were heard. And we have to continue to work together to fight these raids that are happening all across our cities and our country, to fight against the proposed wall, to fight for the kinds of quality programs that we need in our schools and in our community organizations, to fight for net neutrality. I am amazed by everything you said, Andrew. That's like not to allow the fear to take root and to take what we've learned from people like you and from activists across the country who are talking about all of these different tools and how we can use them in the places where we work, how we can use them so that we can collaborate in order to create the city that we want to see, the state that we want to see, the country that our people deserve, whether we are American-born citizens or we're newcomers. We know that we deserve better. And so it's phenomenal to have this opportunity as an educator, but also as a working person to think about the different ways that we can work together to bring about the change that we need to see.
One question I have, which is, again, frightening, is my understanding, you know, we know that education is primarily city and state funded.
Yeah.
However, the federal government gives us in the city of New York about $1.7 billion for education, but guess for whom? For the Title I, which are the poorest students, for students who are disabled so that they can maintain their civil rights, and for basically civil rights and education in general. So when you look at that, the federal government is incredibly important. Can you just comment on how important that really is? Because I just know it from being in the schools, but also statistically, you know it in reality.
I was just doing some research this week on the Office of Civil Rights and thinking about the school to prison pipeline and some of the work that we need to do in our schools around those issues of school discipline. And so I went to the Department of Education's website, and I don't know if any of you have checked out whitehouse.gov, and the purge of all of those documents that were there 3 weeks ago. And so the research that's been done, the data analysis, the data collection around students with disabilities, around discipline, around funding of our most impoverished schools and districts, that information is no longer available to American citizens, to people in this country who use these services. It's so critical that we continue to put pressure on the federal government, not only for Title I, Title IX, IDEA, Americans with Disabilities Act, but also for that important data that we need to have available to us as Americans and using these schools.
If I may just add, one of the critical concerns around Betsy DeVos, I refuse to really get her name straight. But one of the critical concerns is that she's really coming in with an idea about charter schools and, you know, privatization of education. And she showed in her hearings that she didn't really have a full appreciation for the education system and for the responsibilities of the Secretary of Education for the country. And so when we think about civil rights, or we think about supports for children who are disabled and trying to get the best education possible, and we appreciate that she didn't even have a clue, you know, about what is the, you know, the Individuals Disabilities Act and the individualized education plans for children with disabilities. What you appreciate is that if you have somebody who doesn't have that basic knowledge, then how is she going to manage and ensure that those children and that their needs are being supported? Because she doesn't even know what's going on.
Right.
That's what we have to be concerned about.
I would take it a step further. Not only does she not have a clue, she demonstrated an unwillingness to do the research necessary to prepare for that hearing. Well, if any of us are going into a job interview, we do some research. We find out what's going on in that company, what they're about, what they stand for. She didn't even respect the position enough to do the research that was necessary. That's what I find so reprehensible about this candidate.
Well, if Donald Trump was going to put somebody in charge of fighting the Zika virus, he'd hire a mosquito. The sad thing is that if we're trying to look for policy perspectives where we might be able to work with the people who have been chosen for the cabinet, I think it's a fool's errand. Mm-hmm. These people were chosen specifically to dismantle the entire system of equity that this country was founded on. And the sooner we organize to oppose them, the better. And I would just recommend that we don't use the word resistance. Let's save the word resistance for those people who actually put their lives on the line in wars and other times, much harder than what we're facing today. What we have to do is oppose and organize ourselves so we never have to have a true resistance.
Absolutely. So my friend Gene Stone, we met in right after college. I had a friend from high school who was in his class at Stanford, and we became friends. I never thought that this many years later we'd be sitting here talking about unraveling when we had gone to so many anti-war demonstrations, so many poverty-era demonstrations, and so many other opportunities that we took to fight when we were so much younger. And here we are. I went yesterday to the Planned Parenthood demonstration, and I swear to God, it was the same place I had stood some 20 or 30 years earlier as a women's leader, as part of the National Women's Political Caucus, and here I was as borough president in the same location on the same issue. It feels good to be, as you suggest, opposing, but very frustrating because we don't want to go back to those kinds of discussions. We have to move forward. So given our long-term relationship and your amazing writing abilities from Stanford and Harvard, how do you see, after the discussions here, that we can move forward? You just heard the wonderful words from Andrew, but can you add to the ideas that you've gotten collectively from the amazing work that you did writing and talking to so many different people about what activism should be taking place and how we can really make a difference?
Sure. Unlike the other people on this panel who are all extraordinary activists and entrepreneurs, I'm just a writer. It's the only thing I know how to do. But after a week of feeling depressed after the election was over, I thought, well, I have to do something. So I decided to write the Trump Survival Guide, because it's all I really knew how to do. Every one of you out there, every one of you has something they can do, and you have to do it. The point is, you can't wait for us on stage or some leader to motivate you. You have to motivate yourself, and you can do that. It doesn't really matter. Maybe you're a great baker. Organize a bake sale. Maybe you like to be on the phone, organize some telephone line. Every one of you, every single one of you can do something, and you have to decide to do that. You can sit here, this is a great forum. Gail has organized a wonderful event, and like everybody else has said, she's an amazing politician. But every one of you, here you go, every one of you has an amazing skill, something, anything, and it's time for you to be as active and participatory as you've ever been in your life. Because as Gail was saying, we've been taking it for granted. We've been thinking, well, the 70s were tough, the 80s got worse, the 90s got better, the aughts got worse, but things seemed to be going in a very positive direction. And then all of a sudden we were slammed by this election. Don't let it get you down. What you really need to do is do something. Donate money, call a politician, organize an event, whatever you can do. If you can boycott a company you feel is important. I have a list in my book of 60 organizations you can join. There's 100 ideas for what you can do. But the point is, as Gail says, we've been going through this cycle of fighting against what we think is injustice and fighting for justice. There's never been a time where it's more important for every one of you to be involved. So please, if you leave this crowd with anything, it is the desire to do something. So please do something.
Thank you, Jean.
Gail, if I may say a word.
And I just want to obviously echo that by stating we have wonderful organizations here today that are doing something, and please support them and talk to them, and they can help us get involved.
So I just wanted to share, building on your point, Jean, I had an opportunity just last week to spend some time with people who work in food pantries and soup kitchens, and we were talking about this very question of what can you do. And I did my very best to remind them of one of the statements of Martin Luther King Jr., everybody can be great because anyone can serve. And I sought to remind them that Martin Luther King Jr. was not great because he was a preacher or a pastor. That's not what he's remembered for. He's remembered for serving. Congressman John Lewis, he is great because when he was just 15 years of age and he was denied admission to his local state college, he took action. And he wrote to Martin Luther King Jr. and he said, I've been denied admission. I, along with other people. He took action, he stepped up, and he began serving. And today he's great. Our very own Shirley Chisholm, right? Shirley Chisholm, the first African-American congresswoman, the first woman to be on the ballot for a major party's nomination for the President of the United States. Do you know how she started out? She was a nursery school teacher, working to make life better, one child at a time, then one classroom at a time. And then she became a New York State legislator. And then she began working one bill at a time and one campaign at a time. And what we all should take away from that is that any one of us can start with a small act.
Right.
We don't have to run for Congress today. We don't have to be president of the United States of America. We don't have to be president of an organization. But we can start by taking one step, signing a petition, showing up at a demonstration, donating, making our voices heard, and we can be great.
Thank you. In addition to that, I'd like to add that while we are taking this situation coming out of the White House head on, we also need to build bridges on the ground. There are people who do have ideas that are different from ours. It is very important that we sit down and develop relationships, even with people that we don't agree with. And I'm saying this in an extremely informal way, not about putting people on TV. Say in a very informal way, not only with people you don't disagree, that you may not agree with, but then also that neighbor that you may agree with, get to know them. In order for us to be able to do this for the next 4 years, the information and knowledge that all of you have needs to be shared with your neighbor. You may not know that your neighbor actually is undocumented. Right. You would be surprised. You would be surprised. And there's gonna be a moment where they're going to need the help of the neighbors around them to make that emergency call when ICE comes into the building. But they're not gonna be able to do that if they don't know you. So please get to know your neighbors. By serving, you can work together and strengthen those relationships. You don't have to necessarily even leave your building to be of service.
Jean, I just wanted to ask, because I do get a lot of people, I don't even know anybody who voted for Trump. I'm living in a little bubble. But the issue, I just don't. But the
You're
issue,
fortunate.
Or they didn't tell me. They didn't tell me. But the issue is, people do come up to me who are probably more conservative than I am, and they say, Gail, don't you think we should bridge the gap with the people, not those in our building who are undocumented, but the people who don't support our viewpoints and who are supportive of Trump? How did you come across that in your discussions with people while you were writing the book? And how Sure. do you think we should go about that, if we should?
No, that is a very important issue. It's imperative that Democrats understand that while, as has been pointed out, we probably represent half the country, we don't represent the entire country. So we can't expect that we're going to win every time, and we do have to compromise sometimes and work with Republicans, moderates, whoever, to get things done. But there are also times when we have to decide that enough is enough. For instance, if you're talking about the Supreme Court justice, should we fight him or not? I think that's an issue where we probably should fight him. But if you're talking about one of the secretaries of, that Trump's nominated, I think DeVos was worth fighting against, but some of them weren't. So you have to pick your battles. You can't fight everything, but if you intelligently fight a few things, if you all work together and decide what those few things are, then you can actually have victories.
Andrew, in the tech community, I noticed I'm a big supporter of disruptive technology if it's doing the right thing. In other words, technology for the good. But it was quite interesting. Some of the tech leaders met with the president, some didn't. What do you see in terms of what Jean was stating about how do we reach out to people who don't agree with us, and is that something that the tech community is considering?
Well, so first of all, the tech leaders who met with the president were all from California. There wasn't a single New York tech leader that was at the table. unfortunately. So that's another example of how people think Silicon Valley speaks for the entire tech community. It doesn't. But there are people who are actually building organizations that are starting to reach out across what the proverbial aisle and actually talking to Trump supporters to try to identify a common denominator of shared purpose and shared values and not argue over fake news or over politics. And so it's going to take time. You know, people sometimes think that the way this problem is going to get solved is we're going to get new elected leaders and somehow it's going to come from the top down. We've already mentioned a little bit today about doing something. It's actually going to happen neighbor to neighbor, block by block, town by town. We're going to rebuild the fabric of the 21st century democracy, not by a political party that's basically funded by large corporations and corporate and large donations, but rather by individuals talking to each other. And you don't have to agree. All you have to do is listen and say, I heard you. That already changes the relationship from adversarial to one that's possibly more open. But it's going to take time. And if I could just add one more thing, imagine if the Democratic Party was a member-based organization where every single member of the Democratic Party paid a small due, and then we voted on who our elected leader, who the party leaders were, who then built the apparatus for how we actually elect Democrats back into the legislatures, into Congress. We have a broken Democratic Party. So while we are fighting the Republicans, we should be rebuilding the progressive movement of the United States.
You know, Gail, if I may, that's important. So I'm just gonna go out here on a limb and I think it's important that as we seek to build bridges, that we also embrace and acknowledge where different people are coming from. And I'm just going to say, as an African-American woman, I have to, every day, push beyond the fact that I look at others who voted for Trump, and I think to myself, you voted, I don't know why you voted, but you endorsed and supported someone who was espousing hate, who was preaching misogyny. And so I can't just say I'm ready to always step forward. I know I gotta do it, but I have to acknowledge that pain and that when I show up in a conversation, which can sometimes be turned into an altercation, it is because I am coming with my hurt and my pain for America that is decades and centuries old. And before I can just jump into a negotiation, I need that acknowledged. Mm-hmm. It's okay. Just.
I'm afraid now we have to wrap up, so I'll start with you, Angela. If there is some either example of activism that you can remember, I think we're all very focused on it now, or some gap in activism that you want to bring to the audience or bring to all of us, I think we're all trying to figure out, beyond activism, what makes sure, for instance, that we don't lose our diversity in our city because America is strong because of the diversity and the people you represent. I don't understand why the folks in Washington don't get it, but they don't. So how would you suggest that we move forward in all your amazing work?
Well, I'd like to share an example of activism that actually transformed a person's life. Back in 2010, we worked with a young man, John Montreville, and you can look him up. And he had been convicted of a crime many, many years earlier. That was his only crime. He then went on to have a very productive life, originally from Haiti, came here as a child, green card holder, legal permanent resident, married to a U.S. citizen wife, a number of three or four U.S. citizen children, and he had... because he was such low priority, he was not a danger to anyone, but he had been identified by ICE, and so he had to go in for a yearly check-in. So he would go and check in once a year and say, I'm here, I'm not going anywhere, I'm living my life, I'm working, he owned a company. And then one day, right after New Year's, I think it was January 2nd or January 3rd, he went in for his check-in, and they actually detained him and said, we're going to deport you. Right then, because we had a system, I got the call, and immediately we started our conference calls in the morning with different activists and figuring out what strategy are we going to take here. In a week, we had put so much pressure on not only the elected officials that represented him, the head of regional ICE, who was being spoken to directly by a religious leader, that everyone knew who he was inside detention. The pressure continued. We started organizing and stopping the buses coming out of Varick Street and engaged in civil disobedience. The first round were nuns and priests. They all got arrested. We started an online petition, started phone calls directly to ICE's office. The next week, nothing happened. The next week, we did another round, civil disobedience. Then I was included, got arrested. And then the earthquake in Haiti happened. When that happened, our network that was already connected even activated even more, and the phone calls did not stop, nonstop into the key ICE office that we knew that they had discretion. They have discretion to go one way that can be devastating, but they also have discretion to go another way, which is looking at a particular case and saying, okay, this person should be released. They called the reverend that we were working with and said, can you please call off your people? Because of this earthquake, we have to deal with this now, and we don't have the resources, so please stop the phone calls. Is he gonna be released? Stop the phone calls. We stopped the phone calls, and a week later, John Montreville was released. He was, let me tell you how critical the timing was. He was on a plane already down in Louisiana, and they have this whole setup where then from Louisiana you get flown to Haiti, to Dominican Republic, and you're going in chains. I mean, you're being kicked out of this country in the worst way possible. And he was on the plane about to go. The plane didn't leave because someone had a fever. And there's a law that says that if someone has a fever, they can't leave the country. So they took everyone off the plane, and that night the earthquake happened. Okay? So I share that with you because sometimes you may feel that what you're doing is futile, but you never know what changes can happen in a matter of a day where all of that energy that you put in actually bears fruit. So that's one story that I wanted to share. The second piece around activism, I mean, I think that already what's happening is we should just continue doing it. There's so many organizations that are coming together that are identifying and learning how to lobby elected officials. Community-based organizations like myself, I mean, we're already identifying people who are willing to put themselves on the front line. We have people who want to work behind the scenes, which is great. But especially around immigration, it's so important, and I wish either I get help or we work with New York Immigration Coalition, a bunch of other organizations. We need to sit down with the news directors of CNN, ABC, NBC at the national level and say, okay, we need to stop being reactive around this conversation around immigration. There is so much that we provide as immigrants. By the way, this travel ban, it has frightened so many people that even airlines now are saying that we are seeing a decrease in sales. The people that travel in and out of this country, many of them are immigrants, legal immigrants, visiting their family, having family visit them. I mean, we would cripple this economy if we all decided not to get on a plane. So the conversation now, I feel that the media has a responsibility to be proactive and reframe the conversation around immigrants and talk about how absolutely essential, quote unquote, low-skill workers are. They're not low-skill workers, they're essential workers. Let's start forcing them to talk about it that way and about all of the other contributions. And actually, I mean, this country can't exist without us. And that has to be talked about. That, and we need our media to help us frame that.
Thank you.
Thank you.
So very quickly, because we're running out of time, just some closing remarks.
Very quickly, I believe one of the best posters that I saw when out at the Women's March, I was in DC, was a poster being held up by a woman that said, this is not a sprint, it's a marathon. The appreciation that we all must have that we're not gonna see all of the change that we desire in 1 month, in 2 months. We've got to stay at this. It's a marathon. Mm-hmm.
Mm-hmm. Andrew?
So probably the best piece of activism that I can remember is all the people who rose up to elect Barack Obama, the first black president of the United States. And there was a movement of hope and connectivity around the optimism of not only his election, but the possibility of actually achieving a lot of our policy and civil rights and equity goals. Unfortunately, the 13 million person list that Obama created when he was elected was squandered by the Democratic Party. They sent emails to those people asking them to buy t-shirts and hats instead of getting them to run for office or to support candidates or to help small other organizations. So the reason I'm mentioning it is let's not let that happen again. Right. If we're going to get organized to win an election, let's stay organized after the election.
Janella?
The labor movement across the country and here in New York City is facing all of these communities, women, LGBTQ members, those who are poor, those who are disabled, those who are newcomers to our country. And we are here to serve in your hospitals, in the schools, in MTA, and on the streets, picking up the garbage, making sure that our city is running at all times. And we're ready to partner across the city mm-hmm. to make sure that we can organize to create the nation that we all know America was intended to be.
Great.
Gene? I just want to reiterate that it's really going to come down to every one of you. And my hope is that when you leave here, if you're not already involved, you'll become involved, you'll get other people involved, and you will stay involved until we win.
I also want to thank, before I thank the panel, I want to say Assemblymember Carmen De La Rosa is here, Assemblymember Weprin, David Weprin. And the only other aspect of activism we didn't mention is humor. Saturday Night Live is hysterical. I want to thank our panel and Jennifer Jones Austin, Angela Fernandez, Janella Hinds, Andrew Rasiej, Gene Stone. Thank you very, very much.
Pleasure to meet you.
And now, we're very fortunate to have two borough presidents, deputy borough presidents, and they're both going to speak, Aldrin Bernier and Matthew Washington. And thank you all very, very much.
I didn't say anything and you clapped for me. I love you all. Can we all agree that Gale Brewer is an incredible borough president, incredible individual? And what an incredible panel we had today. We're so excited about activism. But let me tell you something about Aldrin and I. Aldrin and I have the hardest job in the city of New York. We work for Manhattan Borough President Gale Brewer, and it is hard to keep up with that lady. But every once in a while, she can't make an event, and we have to go. And when we show up, we say, we're sorry, Gale Brewer will not be here. And children start to cry, and people boo us. But we continue this strong fight because we know we're representing an incredible activist, an incredible individual who's going to stand up for the issues that are important to us. And that's why these organizations are here on this side, so that we have ways to get engaged, to get involved, and to make sure that we're standing up for the things that are important. And one way that we really do that is to make sure that government is funding the things that are important to us. Gale Brewer mentioned our budget hearing coming up on Wednesday, February 15th from 4 to 7. Please come up. If schools need more funding, come and make sure people know about it. If immigration affairs need more funding, make sure people know about it. If your street light is busted, make sure people know about it. But make sure that we're holding government's feet to the fire and putting resources where they need to be to address the issues that are important to us. So thank you very much, and I pass the mic to Deputy Borough President Aldrin Bonilla.
Thank you, Matthew. I just want to say very quickly, I had an opportunity last week to speak with Frederick Douglass, and he wanted me to communicate the following. There comes a time There comes a time in the life of a free people. If you are a free people, there comes a time in the life of a free people where you must stand up and parent your government. You must be parent to your government. When my five-year-old child breaks something, when my five-year-old child breaks something, and I don't mean like breaking the law or breaking the Constitution, but when my five-year-old child breaks something, he usually says, "Nothing to see here, folks. Nothing to see here, folks. Keep it moving. Keep it moving." And that's exactly when the time that I say, there might be something I need to go check out. And I think this is the time in the history of our country where folks are being told, "Nothing to see here, folks. Keep it moving. Keep it moving." And I think this is exactly the time where we need to stand up and see what's happening. We need to march together, stand together, fight together, battle together, and be victorious together. We must make sure that we the people, as imperfect as we may be, that we the people still have to show the government that it's we the people is the reason why they stand. And we the people is what they must be accountable for. So today, this is a great example of what does democracy look like? Show me what democracy looks like. Show me what democracy looks like. So not only is there a lot to see, there's a lot to do. Thank you. We have cookies and everything in the back. Good night. Thank you.